Well, Scott Morrison and Anthony Albanese have gone head-to-head in the final leaders' debate before the election, with the Labor leader declared the winner by undecided voters.
Kind of wasn't robust. To discuss, we're joined by Treasurer Josh Frydenberg in Melbourne. Treasurer, good morning to you. Thanks for your time today. You OK, buddy? You seem
morning,
a little
Carl.
Down
morning,
in the dumps. There you go.
I think I'm feeling pretty well, Carl. I've got, you know, a big battle on my hands in my local electorate, but I've been encouraged by the positive response that I've received over the last couple of days at pre-poll.
Just looking more broadly with the party, it seems like, you know, nothing is landing at the moment. What can you do to turn it around at this stage, or is it too late?
Well, Ali, there's over a week to go to Election Day, and I don't need to remind you that in the lead-up to the last election, a lot of people were writing off our chances, and the Australian people did something very different on Election Day, and we were re-elected. We've got the economic plan to create more jobs, to see small businesses thrive. The Prime Minister, I thought, gave a very strong account of himself yesterday in the debate, and he put forward a compelling case.
So if that was so compelling,
the economy.
So if that was so compelling, then and we've heard these arguments from him during the entire campaign, why isn't it resonating, and why aren't people listening, or why aren't people being drawn to that?
Well, we were starting this campaign from behind as the underdog, but this election will be close, and we know that it will be fought out in a number of seats. And so we'll keep making that case, Ali, between now and Election Day. But the contrast couldn't be clearer between a government that has helped steer the economy through the biggest economic shock since the Great Depression, that has laid out a budget for creating more jobs, for easing the cost of living pressures, for investing more in education and in health. And we did so in the budget just over 4 weeks ago. And Anthony Albanese, who, as you were pointing out to him just a few days ago, that he always has to be surrounded by his shadow ministers. He doesn't know the unemployment rate, doesn't know the cash rate, and now he's making policy up on the run about wages increases.
But it's working. So I tried to take myself inside your head last night, and I was thinking about, and it's not an easy thing to do, obviously, there's a lot going on.
Did you enjoy that?
In parts, because I'm a masochist. but I was thinking about you and the fact that you've put 12 years into this. You guided Australia through, a pandemic. I guess there'd be few people actually who work harder than you in Parliament. You've said everything you can about the opposition, and it still looks like they're going to beat you. This must be crushing for you.
Well, I'm just going to work every day to Election Day and hopefully beyond to serve my local community, to serve the Australian people. But, Carl, to be very honest with you, I don't see my job as Treasurer of Australia about achieving a headline unemployment rate or a headline growth rate or an inflation rate. I see my job as about serving the people behind those numbers, and I'm being stopped by small business owners, by family members in the streets in my electorate who say, thanks for JobKeeper. You actually saved my small business, or you helped keep my family in a job. And now to see Australia coming out of this with a stronger and better performance in all major advanced economies is a testament to that economic management. Mm. And when I meet families who are beneficiaries of drugs that we've listed on the PBS, which we can only do because of a strong economy, that is what makes my job all the more real, and that's why I'm committed to doing it. And to be honest, that's why I went into politics in the first place. Yeah. Australia's a remarkable country, and it gave my family, Carl, an enormous opportunity. My father's parents came from Poland. They came in the 1930s. They moved into the electorate of Kooyong. They're not alive to see it today, but their grandson is holding Menzies' seat. Their grandson is the Treasurer of Australia. That's what makes this country great, that anyone can be what they want to be. And I want to create those opportunities for other people across the country, for the next generation, and that's why I went into politics in the first place.
So that must hurt even more than the fact that you could lose your seat and won't have that opportunity potentially.
Well, Ali, I'm obviously striving to win my seat, and I have been encouraged by what I've heard on the ground. And the people in my community have a very clear choice. They know I've worked hard, as Carla said, every single day for the small businesses, for the charities, for the families in my community, but I've also been the Treasurer of Australia. I've got the detailed plan, the government's got the detailed plan to take us forward. I'm up against the so-called independent, who's a former long-standing member of the Labor Party, something they sought to conceal from the community, and they're asking the community for their vote, but they're not prepared to tell the community how they will vote in the event of a hung parliament. That's the clear choice people are facing.
What will you do if you lose?
Again, I'm not contemplating that. I'm striving, working hard to win.
Tennis?
You could have asked me that question 30 years ago and I probably would have given you that answer.
Good to see you, Josh. It is a brutal game, politics.
Mason, it's yours to lose.
Hey, Ali, we've only got 9 days to go now.
It's nine sleeps left. And it's 10 days. Carl and I have debated this.
It's not 10 days.
It is. I used my fingers. I worked it out. All right, OK, all right. Nine or ten.
People are voting already.
But I do make a point, though. It is, at this stage, yours to lose.
I'd be sceptical about the polls. You know, if you think about what happened 3 years ago, if we got in a time machine and went back to 2019, we were all wrong, weren't we? And I think these polls are wrong as well. But I do sense that people have had it up to their back teeth with Scott Morrison. You saw some of that last night with what people said in the pub after the debate. They're sick of the lies and the rorts, the excuses and all the incompetence. I see it at pre-poll where people are coming up and voting at the moment. You know, people are coming up to me and saying, why did he go to Hawaii when the country was on fire? Why were we locked down so long? You know, we felt it in Western Sydney more than anywhere else last year. And a big part of that was because they didn't order enough vaccines.
So is it this idea that it's not Labor winning it, this is going to be the coalition losing it?
Well, I think it's two things. I think that people have worked Scott Morrison out and they're sick of the excuses and sick of the blame shifting, sick of the rorts. But also Australians are yearning for something better. They want something better and we're offering something better. We're saying, look, we can make childcare cheaper, we can fix aged care, we can make Medicare stronger, we can make it easier to buy a home. You know, we can make sure that we make more things here in Australia, bring manufacturing back. ICAC and a National Anti-Corruption Commission was a big part of that debate last night. We've said that we will set one up this year. Scott Morrison still refused to do that. And given all of the corruption that is pretty obvious happening in Canberra, as well as this Alan Tudge affair that Carl asked Scott Morrison about on the first day of this campaign, and they still refuse to answer why $500,000 of taxpayers' money was paid out in compensation to one of Alan Tudge's staffers. And we find out last night that this bloke, who is in hiding at the moment, refusing to answer any questions, Scooby-Doo would struggle to find him. If in 9 or 10 days' time they win, then this bloke's the education minister. They're treating the Australian people with contempt.
All right, but I mean, you've then got to look at then your leader and the number of gaffes he's made in regards to the election. I mean, that quote, absolute support for a 5.1% minimum wage rise, he's walked back from that. So the question is, did he mean it or not?
Think about it, Ali. The Aussies that are on the minimum wage are on $20 an hour, a lot less than you and me. And if the minimum wage goes up by 5.1%, it means they'll get an extra dollar an hour. That's what we're talking about here.
I understand all of that, but I mean, the PM made the point last night that you can't be loose with the economy, and that has been a problem for your leader.
Well, I'd say to Scott Morrison, you've got a screw loose, mate, if you don't think that people are struggling to pay the bills at the moment. And the people that are struggling the most are the people on the minimum wage. You know, the difference this makes is not whether the kids get to go on an excursion, it's whether they've got a roof over their head, whether you pay the bills or not, whether you're able to pay the rent. You know, it strikes me that this tells you everything about this election, that the Labor Party says if the Fair Work Commission increases the minimum wage by a dollar an hour, we'll support it, but Scott Morrison doesn't. And at the same time that all this is happening, you've got Liberal MPs in Western Australia saying that politicians deserve a pay rise. The only people in this country that the Liberals ever think should get a pay rise are politicians. And I think that shows you just how out of touch this mob are.
Poll out for the leader, out on top. But was it actually a debate or was it a rerun of a chess championship from the 80s? It was that dull. Give me 60 minutes any day of the week. Let's discuss with Queensland Senator Matt Canavan and 2GB's Chris Smith. Morning, boys.
Morning.
Matt, first up, you're a straight-up country lad. You tell it like it is. Your goose is cooked, isn't it?
Absolutely not, Carl. This is very, very close. I mean, even if you were to believe this poll, the Labor Party, they reckon, are getting to 80 seats. That's 4 or 5 seats away from a majority. That's extremely, extremely close. And so this election is going to be close. Your vote matters over the next 10 days. And then on top of that, I don't know if this poll is all what it's cracked up to be. It has an average sample size of just 125 per seat. That's very small. And so I don't think it actually is really telling us all that much, as I say, except to say it's really close and your vote matters.
OK, no offence to that fella from Seven last night with the great hair, but it was pretty dull last night. This was as exciting as it gets.
He's shown a great deal of determination over that period of time to rise from very humble beginnings. And I admire that in Australians, and I admire that in Anthony.
Scott's absolutely committed to his nation, and I admire that.
They were so nice to each other, weren't they?
Made me sick.
I love the fisticuffs.
Same.
The previous debate
Please.
To me, I thought was... I tweeted at the time, now we've got a debate.
Yes.
That, to me, is like an old university debate.
Exactly.
The one that was on 60 Minutes last night was... And I got to say, just in terms of formatics, can I say this? Mark Riley was the host, but all of a sudden, out of the blue, up jumps Lani Scali from The West Australian to sort of add on to the questioning. But... Why wasn't she there at the beginning? And she starts to ask the leaders, oh, come on, what about gender equality? Well, how about some gender equality in the way you present your debate? She should have been there at the beginning.
I would say this. Both leaders seem to be in mothball phase. No one's taking it.
No.
I mean, who wants to lead this country? Matt, that's a problem, isn't it?
Well, I'm with you, Carl. I love a fight, as you know, so I'd much prefer that. I missed it all, though. I was, had flight delays last night, so... didn't get to see any of it, but
right.
Sounds like I didn't miss too much. But I mean, the key issue is that Anthony Albanese keeps making missteps on the economy. He says he's an economist, but I think he might have to go back for some remedial lessons.
But can I say this to you? It doesn't matter. We saw Labor pulling back from his comments, the off-the-cuff commitment to 5.1 increase in the minimum wage. He's actually had a nightmare of a campaign, off to a woeful start, made gaffe after gaffe after gaffe, he had a week off with COVID, but no blows are landing. None of them.
Well, as I said, Carl, this is still very close. It is really, really close. On a seat-by-seat basis, it's going to come down to just a few seats. And ultimately, it's going to be your viewers that decide that. Don't listen to what you read in the papers. It's your vote. It's your choice. And if you're a little bit concerned, if you've got a question mark over whether Anthony Albanese can guide us through these tough economic times, think very twice about this. Because last night was record inflation again in the United States. These are very precarious times, and I don't think Anthony Albanese is match fit to chart us through these very choppy waters.
Even Peter Credlin's writing, I think in The Australian, he's in danger, Scott Morrison, of losing the quiet Australians. When you see conservative writers starting to turn, you know, and I know there's other things in the article, but that's of concern.
Because
he's the only one out the front.
Well, yes, true. Because of the feeling out there that the baseball bats need to come out in some states against Scott Morrison, in WA, in Victoria in particular, I think there's an overwhelming feeling for change, feeling for, oh, we need to whack them and let them know that we need a change.
See that 5.1% that should have been an easy hit, right? Any small business, what, 2.3 million who are either working for or have involvement with small businesses. And that 5.1% is a lot for them to come up with.
But while he's a dunce in terms of economics, and that proves it because the government doesn't set these things, but many Australians don't know that, Carl.
Yeah.
So here he is just hooking, playing a political game. I want to see your wages go up by 5.1%. For some people who don't understand the mechanics, that's a really good political hook.
You talk to me then, Matt, about how the coalition is going to win this election. I'm not going to go through every seat. But just broadly speaking, how are you going to pick up a win at this next election, state by state?
Well, I actually do think the quiet Australians are still out there. And in seats like where I am today, in the Hunter Valley, people are very concerned about their jobs. They're concerned about Labor's carbon tax, which is going to hit hundreds of thousands of jobs in this country. And let's just wait and see when their voices are heard. Because as you alluded to earlier, there's actually three seats here in the Hunter region, and all of the candidates, and James and Brooke and Nell, are doing a great job at representing their local views, the local jobs in this area. There's three seats there, and there's lots of more seats out in the outer suburbs. There's been a lot of focus in this campaign on the well-heeled inner-city seats where the mainstream media lives, but out further from the harbour views, from the riverside apartments, People that are struggling with their budgets, are worried about what Anthony Albanese's got with taxes, with that inability to describe his economic plan. And let's just wait and see how they vote.
All right. It is, I think, telling that you're probably the only member of the coalition who's allowed out of his seat to go and spruik the wares of other candidates around the country. That's how safe yours is. Hey, Matt, just quickly before we go, we're on a tight time frame here. This is one for you and all the country people out there, the country folk, the tough country folk that make this country tick. And Barbie and Ken have had makeovers to reflect these modern times. Barbie now features a pink hearing aid and a prosthetic leg. This is the one, though, that I think is interesting. Ken doll, this morning I can report, has a skin condition. This is...
Far out.
Smithy, this is all inclusive and it's cool.
Very inclusive. Very woke, too. Yeah. Barbie and Ken have gone woke. Well, that does it for me. Seriously.
Do we need to get Matt's opinion?
Yes. Matt.
Well, mate, I've got to take small mercies here, Carl. I'm just glad there's not a drag queen. Doesn't seem to be a drag queen for kids, but maybe that's coming. But I just get I get really frustrated with companies, big multinational companies trying to prove that they're somehow this, you know, wonderful charity organisation.
That's
just
the point.
Trying to make money. Let's be, they're just trying to make money.
It's just a money making venture.
I don't know if they'll fly off the shelf.
Well, it must be money and work. Good on you, mate. Thank you. And best of luck to you, Chris, too. Oh.